appreciate the likes of Trevor Quickshot, Hendrick,
Pyratex,
and Dracos.
Sadly today, Dracos, of course, is sick.
The Sifa guy, wherever he's gone.
Sifa hated that guy, so I'm glad he's gone.
Yep. But good, we get double colored here. Double analysis, in the champ select. Lay down the law, what's going to happen?
Well, I mean, the bans are always super boring in the current meta. I can't wait for the next patch. We might get something new.
7.5 is going to be so interesting.
So far, Rengar, LeBlanc, obviously, and Varus, we expect from the Misfits side over on blue side, sorry, red side. H2K and blue, you have a bit more freedom, so you can ban out some comfort.
See, like a lot of Elise bans.
Yeah, but I think you want to get the Elise if it is, but this is interesting, clearly because Power Vivo and Fevern are both huge Cinder players.
And it's not a champion worthy of a first pick.
Right.
But it is a champion worthy of a first rotation on the purple side.
Yeah, you need to leave the first pick open for things like LeBlanc, Varus. Just the option, if you know they are being left open. Now, Misfits will most likely ban both. And then you're still looking like we see Jay's first picks, not as often anymore. But then also there's like different junglers. With Rengar banned, Graves first.
Graves is just, for me, a solid opener because I don't think he loses a single jungle matchup. He can play different routes, which is incredibly important. When you play versus an experienced jungler, being able to kind of switch up your routing, arrive at any point in the map, at any point of time, hide your jungle pathing by just doing some leashless starts, very important.
Just the Elise you mentioned before, Crepo. So we're pinching jungle pool once again. Still a lot of viable junglers, which is very good. It's a fairly deep pool at the moment. And again, we're expecting LeBlanc here to get room. She actually is being
She's
left open.
Open.
Are you crazy?
You had a stat earlier. How many games?
Yeah, so on 7.4 in Europe, she's been banned in 26 games out of 26.
She's always been banned a lot more, even on 7.3.
Even before, yeah. Hovering the Rammus, classic Odamna. He's a one-trick champion. Will be LeBlanc first pick.
I actually loved when Rammus was metagame.
I didn't. It was so simple and so dumb to look at because you literally couldn't kill him in a side lane. But
players of my caliber.
Wow, LeBlanc got first pick. What a surprise.
Yeah. Nice hype there. Maybe you want to do the play-by-play? Oh, LeBlanc locked in. What is actually Misfits' counter pick here? Because they left it up with a purpose.
I mean, yeah.
And they have to get their counter pick in first rotation because I don't think they have an obscure enough champion that H2K is not going to find in the second bat
phase.
Not
that we know of.
Not that we know of.
Or maybe Misfits don't know what they're doing either, and then how could H2K know? Obviously, they will have a counter ready, so Time Kench, a soft one in that sense. I wonder if we get Ryze from Power of Evil. He has been practicing it so much in solo queue. Just to have like this kind of setup where when LeBlanc goes in, you can
punish.
Instantly just W her, you can save whoever target she's going for with the Time Kench. You don't have to pick the Ryze now if you still want your jungler or you prefer the AD carry in like a Jhin, and then you can take Ryze next time. But there are definitely other picks depending on the matchups. There's the Ryze.
Yeah, and this is a pick that traditionally, if you look like at the history of Power of Evil, he wasn't really playing that often.
No.
And it was often criticized for not having it in his champion pool, and that is a story we've told a lot about PoE, especially on Origin. This guy was struggling. He really didn't look as good as he did in the past, and the resurgence he's made with the Misfits team and infrastructure around him has definitely shown a different light on the player.
Now, I want to see H2K punish bot lane. I can see Time Kench so early. I would love to see something like, again, like a Karma lane, something where they can really get a lot of pressure and try and like bully around it, because you know LeBlanc is going to play 1-3-1. If you get that bot lane tower down, end the laning phase that way and shift her into that lane.
Yeah, I think H2K is actually just going to punish the bot side of the map here.
Yeah, bot side of the map.
An aggressive jungle, not necessarily the bot lane itself. You can punish a bot lane without picking bot lane champions necessarily here, and that's what they're doing here with the LeBlanc and the Lee Sin. They're hovering like, we know Azir is your counter, don't even try it. We are aware this champion exists. And they go for the Ashe.
Again, they wanted a bit of pick potential, especially from the bottom side. H2K clearly setting up for this 1-3-1 skirmish pick comp.
Yeah, now Misfits, they have an AD carry they would like to lock in, and preferably a jungler as well.
Well, that's the thing now. Misfits, they have the chance to like pick the jungle and then start, you know, just matching. And simply say we can now like just ban our supports. We have already shown Time Kench.
Ooh.
They're going for this full tank
game scaling
where LeBlanc just won't kill a damn thing.
It does make sense though with the Iron. When you play Iron, everybody becomes a tank. Like the shield,
exactly.
The double locket that you build up, it just makes it so hard for H2K in teamfights to find a pick. But if you isolate them,
then of course you can pick them off left and right, but also if you focus on early game.
Yeah.
you can punish Misfits before they get to the point where the time cans, the rise, the iron all start becoming super powerful. So I want to see that range support coming in from H2K to try and really dominate the bottom side of the map. Top lane as well. You can still go for tank there because you got Lee Sin, LeBlanc, Ashe. That's already enough like pick potential. You don't need it from your top lane specifically. But I want to see some focus on a fast early game because otherwise Misfits are just drafting this, as we normally call, like easy to play late game comp with Ivern.
But if Misfits ban out Chandalas here, maybe harder for H2K to find a suitable tank. They get rid of Renekton. They don't want to play full Snowball early game, so they're looking for an anchor.
Oh, they took the Kama away. Smart.
In the top lane.
I like this.
Is that Misfits planning to first pick Nautilus? Because I think if you ban these two champions, you have to just pick it up. Because if you hand it over to Oduwamne, you give such a good answer and it's such a good fit in the composition.
Or they just say, you know what, let's get our AD carry and save last pick for Alfari.
Play a Trundle.
Play Trundle maybe, see if we can get some sort of value against a potential Nautilus. But because Nautilus is so powerful, obviously you can't just take him.
Because a Ryze Trundle comp could actually play a really solid 1-3-1 here.
With Time Kenshin mid lane.
With Time Kenshin mid lane.
Yeah. Both sides for extra support. So there's definitely value in saving a top lane pick and just go Jhin here. And just kind of match the bottom lane.
I like what HTK do. They ban out the Ezreal, but wouldn't an Ezreal have been too slow for Misfits, I feel? Like, wouldn't you actually be sad if you're HTK that the enemies pick Ezreal? You already have full scaling on every single role locked in so far. I think they would have been happy playing against this. Because now, if you force Misfits in a slightly more aggressive, you know, bandaid solution like Caitlyn, I think you lose momentum on your Snowball.
Well, you can still play something like Zyra here and have, like, a super strong 2v2 bottom lane if you are H2K and play around it. Malzahar, of course, is banned as always.
Yeah, let's not forget, usually when we see Caitlyn, we see, oh, this champion will win bot lane. But traditionally, Ashe has been a fine matchup into Caitlyn. If you pair that with, just like you were talking about earlier, support range disadvantage, then it is fine. Caitlyn will not solo carry this lane. The problem is, it is much easier to push through an Ezreal Tahm Kench lane than it is through a Caitlyn Tahm Kench.
Probably a good chance to see Nautilus again. Not the most exciting one, but just to get a bit of stability up from the top lane, and you don't really know what else you're going to play against. Rumble is another one where a lot of top laners say he doesn't really have that many like hard counters.
Nope.
So you can kind of lane him against everything. I've even seen, you know, Udame take it into Jace when everyone else thought Jace would like destroy that lane, and he went even. So.
And if you look at the preferential play pattern for Rumble, it is literally just shove, shove, shove.
Yeah.
Right. And if you look at the other matchups, I think LeBlanc with positive jungle pressure from Jankos is going to push as well.
That's the key one. You need the jungle pressure. 1v1, Ryze will do fine.
Yes.
You need the Lee Sin around you, but that's again what HK is drafting for. Like, Misfits are literally surrendering to the early game. They're like, yeah, we don't care. We're just going to wait it out. We're going to get to 25, 30 minutes. We're going to play team fights.
Vastly different stories that we're telling with these compositions here. H2K, if Jankos can assist the LeBlanc push in the mid lane, that pressure can spill over in both side lanes. Ashe and Lulu will be able to push even 2v3 at one point. This lane is so destructive when it comes to just push-poke. Oduwamne, as long as he has vision or knowledge of where Kakao is, he will push in the top lane as well. So this is a very tough early game for Misfits to survive.
Now, H2K drafted this kind of composition against Flash Wolves at IEM in the semifinal, third game with the Rumble top, you know. No pure tank. And they couldn't play it. They actually fell completely apart. And Flash Wolves ran over them.
But they did say...
They say they learned a lot.
They learned a lot.
And also, Misfits, we can't say they're at the level of the Flash Wolves just yet.
No.
They obviously have to prove that first. So, could be a vastly different story. And this time, LeBlanc has been locked in. A pick that Ryze in the past has been able to deal with. But one mistake. One mistake, Mitch. LeBlanc has two kills, and then she takes over the entire game.
Oh, it's very important that Misfits play super clean early game here. As you said, a single mistake could mean that you actually fall to H2K 0-2, and we wouldn't want to see that, ideally for the series. I think if you're an H2K fan, I think you're happy.
Definitely happy. Maybe probably will even smile.
And if you're an H2K fan, you can support them on Twitter, at LOL Esports, hashtag H2KWin. If you are rooting for the Misfits, hashtag MSFWin. Where's your hashtag going? Official?
Oh, I mean, who I'm rooting for, who I think will win. I mean, it's
hard
to say.
You're rooting for no one because you're an unbiased professional color caster.
I'm rooting for you, Mitch.
Thank you, I need it. Who do you think will win?
I think, I mean, it's hard to say because it so depends on the early game. In this match here, I think the composition is strong from H2K. I like the amount of options they have when it comes to creating picks and forcing fights. But you can never, never, never disrespect is like really slow comps, especially here in Europe where teams don't always
play perfect.
Snowball and play perfect, yeah.
You need to look at it. We told the story. We're telling it again. Early game snowball for H2K. Scaling and buying time for the Misfits. We saw them use the Ivern to great advantage very early in the season. On a jungler like a Cow, traditionally in his prime, not really what you would think is the utility support type jungler.
No, and I even think at this point, like, I like me some Kakao. I especially love him when he plays Lee Sin, even Rengar last game. So it makes me a little bit sad when I see him play Ivern, because I'm like, you don't need to. You're so good, you can just get fed on your own and you can like carry these games. But of course, a well-played Ivern is a very strong utility tool.
Does he micromanage Daisy better than other junglers?
Oh, that's probably it, you know. His Daisy mechanics
APM
are top-notch.
Getting the shields. Another standard invade here.
Just because, so what Ivern likes to do is start on bottom side with blue buff. So often, like, you prep your blue buff, or sorry, you prep your wolves, you go down, you smite your blue buff, then you prep your Grom, you can go up again, take your camp. So Yangus, he knows this.
This is super greedy from him, though. Usually you would just steal away a buff and disappear. To incorporate the new and kind of improved Raptor start is actually quite greedy, but it'll give a very good path here for Yankos, because the problem is when...
Well, if we just go to the Ivern now, we can see again what he expects is this very standard path, but Kakao's on his way. He's taking the blue buff with Smite.
But no Smite, so he can't actually... Once Yankos sees blue buff, he knows that he can just steal this away super easy, even if Kakao contests.
So Kakao actually expected the red buff to be where Yankos started. So that's why he's checking the Raptor camp. That is gone. So this is a really good start for Yankos, because now, if he paths down to his own red buff, he actually stops Ivern.
That's the point I was trying to make before I was rudely interrupted by my co-caster. Now PoE is actually in trouble here. Looking to dodge a chain here. He's in the minions, has to flash. Yankos flashes in for red buff. QQ, and it's over. Power Evil is crying. H2K with a phenomenal start.
But now here, Power of Evil, your jungler should have just called. I've lost two camps in my topside jungle. Watch out, where could Lee Sin be? On the top side of the map, because Kakao checked the red buff and didn't find anything.
Yeah.
And he saw the Raptor camp was gone, so Power Evil was staying in the middle of the lane, pushing a little bit forward, was just setting up for Yankos to gank him.
Yeah, not very smart here, no good team communication. It's also super easy for Odoamna to keep pushing. And if there's any jungler that gets disrupted the most by being forced into a single quadrant and then moving over, it is Ivern, because he needs kind of that cross-quadrant setup. He needs to set up part of his jungle somewhere, move over, set up the other part, cash in, and then move back to the new jungle that he set up. But right now, Kakao is forced to do a single camp per smite cooldown, so he's falling very far behind.
And it's just a nightmare start for Misfits, because they did not want to fall behind this early. They did not, for some reason, expect Yankos to come from that top side and get a kill mid. And this actually stops, you know, aggression as well from Power View, because he has no flash now.
No. He's playing into a bunk. Yes, he has cleanse, but if Yankos shows up, that is irrelevant. Right now, Yankos gets revealed, low HP, so that means all the lanes can breathe a little bit. But Misfits, we have to remember, they only played with a substantial deficit in 2.3% of their games in the early game. This is a whole new world for them.
And last game was even in gold. But once we got to like the early parts of the late game, HK did have control.
Yep.
Misfits could simply not react with their composition. Another sad thing here for Power of Evil is the fact that his first back did not reward him a tier. And that is like the real QQ moment, because you need so little gold to get it, and then you have to settle for boots.
Yeah, settles for boots, has a single potion there.
So he has to recall another time to start getting the tier, and it really just prevents Power of Evil from kind of rushing towards Tier Catalyst, which he needs to lane against LeBlanc.
Yeah, Tier Catalyst Negatron is definitely the breaker in that matchup. Once you get all that, it's so hard for Fevin to push through. At that point, he wants to play on side lanes. Yankos, again, he's just looking to find Kakao.
A little bit off
down
timing.
Yeah, it's very easy, of course. If you're 2 seconds too late, that camp is gone.
Yeah, and what we see again, it was kind of the thing that we saw introduced at IEM from some of the teams against European teams.
Yeah.
Like, to play around Raptor camp, it's the most experience from that specific camp. And that's why Yankos tried to time it. His top lane Alfari is full HP, and there's no level 6 photo Amne.
This is a tough dive, especially if Alfari can't flash. He's taking a lot of damage right now. Yankos just, they connect everything. Alfari just straight up dropping, not electing to flash anything. May have been the right choice there. Now Chase under pressure, Kakao finds bot lane, cross that play here. Can nuclear survive? Burns heal, has flash left. And again, we were talking about this 2v3. These guys are super safe, because any sense of aggression from the Misfits bot lane will betray the gank.
Yeah.
These guys have been playing passive the entire game. Suddenly, of course, they will know Kakao is there.
It's not like Kakao wants to gank the bot lane either. It's more, oh, my top lane is dying. I have to do something on the map. And you go down to this Tahm Kench lane, and it's kind of like, meh, we don't have the damage to kill them. And that's a problem. And Yankos now, two assists already. His two solo laners have gotten kills. Great start.
Yeah, and more importantly, he can actually hand over this blue buff to Fen right now. Looking at the game one stats, both these junglers were honestly pivotal in their compositions. They were very important to any of their one fights, but Jankos still performed just slightly better right now. He's really dominating Kakao in this matchup.
And now again, different setup with Ivern for Kakao. So Kakao is not a playmaker in this game. He's relying on the rest of the team. But the rest of the team right now, if you look at the soul laners, they're falling behind.
Yeah, 10 CS and counting here on Alfari, whose lane has bounced out. Jankos getting the safety ward first, and they're looking to set up another dive.
Yeah, Odo has level 6 now, so they can go for another one. I think Jankos might get 6 on his camp.
I think he's just making sure that Ivern is not there as well, so they know they're not getting counterplayed. Look at how much damage Alfari is taking from keeping
dead.
This
he's
wave
so
out.
He's so dead.
There's no way to survive this. Maybe 1-for-1 if the dive is botched, but it's so easy. Flash goes out, Jankos connects, and that's it right there.
Yeah.
Odo Omne really going to town on Alfari. Wanted to see him in a carry matchup. It's been tank versus tank. And H2K's experience is really showing through.
Yeah, this is not about the 1v1. It's about Jankos against Kakao. And right now, Jankos on the Lee Sin, winning out. Kakao's here, but it should just fizzle out.
Nope. Ooh, he gets caught. The juke predict there from Kakao.
Oh, okay. That was good.
That was nice.
That was good.
He didn't even flash. He knew.
No, yeah. Jankos got juked.
He's in his head right now.
Jankos is like, oh, I can do everything. I'm the king of the world.
I can size up the skill shot.
And his little candy thing kind of flies at him. And Kakao outsmarts Jankos on that one.
I do like this move for Misfits. Whenever you lose the map, it is always good to shake it up and send your bot lane to a different lane.
What's very interesting, though, was how them swapping top was the reaction to, hey, our top lane's gonna die. You know, our top lane, he's screwed. Problem is, they arrive like 5 seconds, 6 seconds too late. And then he goes down anyway. Good return kill. See it again, Mitch.
Yeah. I mean, I'm the play-by-play here, technically. But yeah, the ulti goes down. It's so easy for H2K to execute all of this. Because Kakao just isn't in the right spot. Also, Ignar and Sama were coming, so a case can be made for maybe having somebody flash. You know, flash towards your Tahm Kench. If Ignar was just a little bit faster there.
Okay. Let's see skill shot. Come on.
You want to play by play?
Let's see it. Okay, so here. Woo! And he rocks.
That was actually surprisingly accurate.
I've been practicing. Learning my Ivern sounds.
Nuclear looking to push out here. H2K just looking to not get surprised because that's the only way Misfits fight back.
Good ult here from Odo Amner to stop the wave. Might get caught out though, Mitch, and he is probably going to die from this one because now it's devour time.
And they're dropping power. Vivil drops out in the mid lane, getting pressured out. Odo Amner lost his life, so this is a good moment to breathe for the Misfits. But they're still losing that third pressure in the top lane.
Yeah, Odo Amner here, so the plan for him was, I'm just going to ulti the wave and I'm going to peace out. Because then I kill the wave, we get a huge tempo advantage on the push and we can get a top lane tower. Sadly for him, two guys showed up and again, Kakao hits the skill shot.
Sounds like a good plan, but in essence, still the map configuration is much better for H2K here because they have all this pressure on all these towers. And the second one tower fell, which did in the top lane, the map goes open. And that is definitely what H2K want in their comp.
Everything Kakao's been doing so far is damage control. Like, he's just trying to get something back for his team because they fell so far down. Great swap screen here.
What's happening?
You guys can see we got cutting away some of the champions, but they are killing a tower in top and bot lane.
Misfits, they win the race. Somewhat they get a turret down, but there's a 2-2 falling here, and it's an extremely long lane right now. If you can put Fevin right there, you can really assassinate.
This gave me some old lane swaps.
Flashbacks
right here where, oh my god, they didn't bounce the wave on top side. Big wave now for the enemy top laner. No longer really matters.
What only matters right now is mano a mano mid lane matchups. And in the first game, we saw Fevin outclass Power Evil in the CS department. He had a lot of pressure.
But again, I feel like Syndra. It was supposed to be a 1v1, but dirty tricks from Fevin, always calling for his friends when stuff is about to go down, and then suddenly there are two beating up on Power of Evil.
Yeah, but he still had a good CS lead early on, pressuring that Ahri. This time he was cheating, though. He brought more people to the party. Here we go.
Does it again.
Enchanted Crystal Arrow. Ignar goes low. He has the great health, but it's not enough. He drops, had flash, had exhaust, but he was just not ready to flash out.
Misfits are just not ready right now to play against this kind of composition where so many things are happening, all started with Jankos. And everything is dropping. Second, third tower.
Yeah.
I'm gonna change it too.
A lot of towers are falling, is what we're saying.
Towers are falling, guys.
Towers are falling, people are dying, and more importantly, Misfits cannot afford to do this with their comp. They opted in for a super late game scaling because they felt like the last early game went so even. So they just put all their eggs in the late game basket, but right now they fall 3.7k gold behind in the early game. That is such a disgusting lead for H2K.
Guys, 10 minutes in, this is far away the biggest deficit. Misfits have been in all split long, and now we have to see how they play when they're this far behind. Like, at some point you can't do anything.
No.
Like, you literally just can't do anything if the enemy team is playing correct. So I like this from H2K. You put Fabian on the bottom side because now you can push out mid. Caitlyn at this point is so weak. She has no Hurricane. You know, she can't wave clear that fast, so you can just push out the mid lane and you can roam. That's what you see Nucleus doing. You see it also from Che. He's in the enemy jungle. So now you get full control of the bottom side.
Yeah, Che is so comfortable just invading on his own, really, because the risk of getting caught out is extremely low. The only counterplay that really exists for the Misfits right now is a Tahm Kench ultimate combined with a lingering deport for a teleport. Surprise H2K, 5v3 at the start, get a kill, and then try and snowball. But they are facing a gargantuan lead here in the second game of the series.
Yeah, that's so hard to do because you can just like toggle the H2K vision, and you're also gonna notice not only with wards, but with minions, how much extra vision they will get. Like you can see in the jungle, there's a lot of wards from H2K being placed. Power Beaver has to just back away from his tower.
Yeah, they're playing a defense game, damage control, but Jankos is not alone. He brought his friends to the party, he gets the wild growth here. Taking some damage. The Daisy mechanics, they're sublime, but Daisy got nerfed a little bit. It's not enough.
And every time it's back and pushing lanes. Because whenever you push, minions go further up into the enemy lane, you get more vision.
Yep.
Because you can see more and more. You can see every entrance, you know, to the jungle. You can see where
sixth man from Blaze.
It's kind of unfair.
Back in the day.
The sixth man. Now we have Rift Scuttlers too.
Seven. The seventh Scuttle.
Seven. You might get a Baron.
The fans, technically the eighth man.
The fans, are they?
Yep. Two casters. Yeah. We're getting to 11. Getting to football.
We're back, you know, we circle back to the first game's talking point.
Jankos rewards himself with a blue buff. It's like, yeah, my mid laner's in the bottom side of the map. I could keep this
look
alive.
Look how he's doing two camps at once. What a beast.
This is
maximizing. Use that in your solo queue games, but what will happen is you're gonna walk over, you're gonna reset the blue buff, and you're not gonna get it.
It's actually a valid jungle strategy with Fiddlesticks.
He doesn't exist. So, no. Nothing is a viable jungle strat with Fiddlesticks.
So if you go into a bot game...
No!
No!
The minions will just kill you.
Fiddlesticks. There are a couple one-tricks.
A few one-tricks.
There's a couple of one-trick Fiddlesticks that are higher yield than you.
That doesn't really require a whole lot at the moment, Crepo, but... What makes me happy is that you play, what is it, what, 700 ranked games so far? And you're actually on your way down towards...
Che and Nuclear right now pushing in the middle.
Uh-huh, okay, I see it.
They're pushing in the middle lane, trying to put pressure here. LeBlanc in the bottom lane. Martin, tell me what's next here for H2K. What is their plan? What is definitely not my Diamond 2 Elo?
Okay, okay. The plan is bot lane control again, my friend. This bot lane tower will die very soon. Ignar has to try to hero play, but he's spotted every single time.
I can feel the tension in your voice. It feels like you really care.
It's just so hard for Misfits to do anything. Like, they're really trying, but...
They got a ward.
It just feels like they don't have the skills right now, much like you in solo queue.
I think they had the skills. I think they were just a little bit unlucky. Sometimes their team's dragging them back. Poor Hansama and Ignar, they're just laning in a defensive matchup, and suddenly their jungle dies twice, right?
Like, right.
What can you do?
Except for in this case here, the jungler has actually been carrying.
It was their top laner.
Turns out support is just whining. And now we go back to the game, Crepo. Let's see what's happening here. H2K.
I thought we were talking about the game.
Oh, yeah, yeah, of course, of course. Full vision. We want to see this bot lane tower fall, open up the map even more. And then, where's the juicy fight so we can get you a smooth play-by-play voice?
Fabian looking to not get cut out. The vision's really important right now, because if Misfits can get a single pick, they can eliminate all these control wards that HGK have built up. So it's really important that Fabian does not get overzealous. No hubris here, getting surprised by Kakao.
And it is important that he also wins on this LeBlanc when we finally get to see her, because this will be the last patch where she is a champion. Soon she is long gone.
I mean, she basically becomes Talia in 7.5. Wave clear bot in the mid lane, trying to push.
The old Olaf technique. Remove him for 2 years.
But one day, she will be back.
She will return.
For the Clone Wars.
And now H2K will soon get this bot lane tower, because again, push in mid. You're gonna see it all the time. They just always push mid, and then they move into this jungle. Jankos needs to join. He's been farming and farming and farming. He's the strongest member. He's now back with the team. And like, Fairman should get this bot tower now.
Yeah, he can actually get access to that. What I like a lot is the instant Ruby Sightstone upgrade as well here.
Oh, sorry, this is greedy. You gotta run, mate.
Misfits, they're trying to hold on, but what an arrow here, following up by Nuclear. Jankos gets thwarted, disengaged. They're respecting the follow-up. Ignar's here, Kakao following too.
I want to see Jankos be a little bit more aggressive. Not on Nelfari right there.
Not on the tank.
But like, join in when Fairman is pushing in the wave, so you can just take that tower. They're gonna get it now, it's fine. They just allowed it to stay up for quite some time. They took it slow.
Minus points from Deficio.
Not minus points,
but they're still a professional team, and they do get that fourth turret right now versus one really going to town on the Misfits. Only two turrets and only two kills, rather, and a single turret for the Misfits so far with their late game scaling composition.
And we talked about, you know, the battle for second best team in Europe coming into this one so far. Game one was fairly even, but obviously in favor of Mitch, H2K in the end.
Figure of Mitch.
I am
the second best team in the European LCS. I've done it.
It's been a few years since that happened.
Yeah, it's been quite a while.
But Misfits, actually, were you ever the second best in LCS?
Always the best or last.
Okay.
Never in between.
But I think for Misfits, like, if they end up losing the series, you know, when the art is far behind in this game already, it shows they still have stuff to work on, which is really good. But for a new team in the LCS, they're still very well-rounded.
Yeah, they definitely they play well in most aspects, so they never had a crucial flaw that they could get exploited. Also, for this game too, the replay will be very easy to analyze. Mm-hmm. Don't get invaded this early and make sure you have a backup jungle path done. Because if you draft this type of comp, you cannot afford what happened there, and that was a beautiful punished by H2K and Jankos.
I mean, a lot of it comes down to level one warding.
Yes.
You know, when you see Jankos invades into place a ward in your camp, you can actually place a ward yourself. You see, if he starts that, then you go his red buff. You know, suddenly Power Viva gets the Q. Do not stand towards the top side. He won't die for, or he doesn't die to a level two gank. And then suddenly the game is very different for Misfits. But small things in League of Legends can often snowball into very big things.
Especially when it's great teams pushing that snowball down the hill. 5,000 gold right now for H2K in the lead. They can set their eyes on other objectives. They've been playing slightly slow, or seems to be slow, because they're simply just waiting for objectives to come out. They're not tunneling on kills. They know they can even farm, keep this gold lead as is, steal away some jungle, and just play the vision game, because they can always get every single objective here. If you contest a Rumble, an Ashe, a LeBlanc this early with your comp that scales, you will just get butchered.
Yeah, get it. So this is a good play, actually. Ignar trying to make a cross map play on Odo Amner.
Two tanks, technically, so Odo Amner could survive. There's another Rise here. Coming in, Power of Evil, trying to chunk down Odo Amner. Odo Amner gets a kill. He flashes, he jukes one.
Get
jukes
excited,
two.
Mitch!
Fari drops out. He is still a tank, so he will survive. For a second, I thought my co-caster would actually do a single team fight.
I thought we agreed.
He stopped talking.
Well, Ignar right here didn't actually have time, I think, to pop his E, so he ends up dying.
Yeah, nuclear.
Oh, he just end up standing there, taking the whole thing. So mid lane tower,
mid lane turret under siege. Kaylin can't hold because obviously she only has a Runan's BF here. And even though there is a semblance of a cross map for H2K, it still isn't enough because they lose more on the back end every single time.
They get a one for one and nothing else. Yeah. That's the problem. If you got, you know, the kill and maybe a tower, it's great. Now you just lost your mid tower, bottom lane tower under pressure. This is what happens when you have like three lanes pushing against you.
Yeah, because every single time a kill happens, it translates into objective if you have lanes pushing. And that's also the advantage of this comp. When H2K get caught out, they don't really lose that much. Like, what is Odo Amner really losing here except a little bit of his pride?
And his life right now. So Ignar goes in, Afari with him as well. So the Ryze joins, arrow comes in. That's why Ignar is stunned. Max range, can't pop his E.
Oh, he can't get the great health off.
Just a great arrow, honestly, coming from Nuclear.
Yeah, and that Nuclear arrow, not only does it kill Ignar, it also forces Alfari to flash. So if Misfits want to go for a bit of a decisive play, they no longer have access to that flash on Nautilus.
So once again, Misfits on the back foot. I like the fact they go for a cross map play. It's like,
it's so easy to sit back and do nothing.
Of course, that's what other teams have been doing, and we've been criticizing them a lot for it. Because like, there's no point in just sitting and waiting to lose the game. In this case, there is obviously a case to be made for being defensive because you have scaling on your side.
To a degree.
To a degree, but like, you still have your bot lane tier 2 outer turret. You can hold on to that one for a little while. It will drop at some point.
I mean, you should become a motivational speaker.
Hey, you got one thing left in life.
Yeah, you're 6,000 gold down in the dumpster versus one of the better macro teams in Europe. But hey. Have you looked at the bright side? There is still a turret with like 200 health remaining.
Yeah, it's still there. And you haven't lost the Baron yet because it just spawned. So you can now fight around it, or at least you can tell your team, hey guys, they don't have Baron yet. They can't finish.
It could technically get worse. Will it get worse? We'll find out when H2K is actually setting up the vision for this Baron Nashor. as they are playing versus Misfits, who have now achieved their larger deficit in the league so far. Power Evil drops out, cleanses, not enough, gonna arrow, fouls, he drops, Jankos kicks him in, bounces up on Sama, bounces up Ignard, he has to flash out, Kakao cannot do enough, because Jankos is here for turn number two, Sama flashes out, Jay, Oluwana, they're all chasing, and Misfits, they're getting torn apart, barbecued by this rumble.
Oh, it's looking so grim now, Power Evil getting caught out, and they actually forced a fight. The Misfits didn't want.
Yeah,
they didn't want to fight.
Nobody wants to fight this lineup from H2K, because while they are 1-3-1 and kind of skirmish pick focused, if you fight them in a choke point, you even get the hero cleanse, it is simply not enough. Fabian looking for more.
Looking for Kakao, just want to force him away so he can't steal it. We saw that yesterday. Sneaky Ivan plays, and you know, I did say a minute ago as a good thing, hey, at least I don't have Baron yet. That one is gone, so now you have your tier 2 tower bot.
Divizio, you still have your tier 2 tower in the bot lane, and I think that is the saving grace here for Misfits. They can all just go stand under it and let them end in the mid
just
lane.
Just defend that tower. Honestly,
save that KVA.
Power Evil thinks he's safe because he has control ward, but that's the problem again. You have just no vision on the map. And now you get forced into this fight because everyone wants to save Power Evil.
Yeah. I like the teamwork for Misfits, they leave no man behind. But that was a beautiful kick from Jankos as well. He kicked him right before he turned into a corpse, into two people, the knock-up. Some great chasing potential here.
Fedrin.
There's an Ahri in the game.
Apparently Fedrin is Ahri, and there's a Jhin too. So let's just assume this is the one from the fight, Fedrin with 4k damage. There's a reason LeBlanc has been banned in, what was it again, Mitch? 26 out of 26 games.
Yes, that was it.
On this patch. Great research there by you, Mitch. Finding that number as well.
Sometimes you gotta share, you know.
Sometimes,
before games, we sit together, we talk about the prep. Martin asked me, can you give me something to talk about? Because...
No, they lost the tower!
Oh.
Ah!
That's it.
Now it's looking bad for Misfits. Now it's looking real bad.
What can they do without the turret?
It's like in the Battle of Helm's Deep when they lose the part of the big wall, you know, where he runs in and blows up the mine. It's like...
Also, that one guy should not shoot that arrow that early. That was Misfit. That was Kakao.
Did he shoot it there?
Yeah.
Couldn't even... I don't know. Yeah.
Started the entire fight.
I'm always like, someone else would have picked it up anyway and ran with it. So
start of the fight.
Yeah, it really didn't matter. Oh, that guy. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. I love how every single movie reference you make is literally Lord of the Rings, because you do not watch any other great cinema.
I watch... Yeah, that's true. It's pretty spot on. Don't remember the last movie I watched.
Nope. Probably on a plane.
Yeah, I was on a plane.
Because that's the life of Martin the Fisher Linger. Busting out the curls in the gym.
And then I had that 80-minute game the other day. Yep. It's a very slow movie. Wasn't very romantic, but I like the ending, you know? A guy actually won his first game, so it's kind of like, you know, a feel-good movie in the very end. Sadly for Nehun, he didn't win his series.
That's
so.
Fine. I got to see two clowns. Usually have to pay for the circus. Here at Riot Games, I get it for free.
And here you're, of course, referring to the casters, not the
players. The casters, the players.
Okay. So, let's see HK pushing three lanes at the same time. I feel like we've seen this all game long, and we talked so much in Champs League about how hard it was for Misfits to defend. When you're basically losing everywhere.
They have one good defensive tool, which is that line of traps. The problem is it only holds one lane at a time. Kakao is placing a brush in the base and then definitely telling his opponents, I'm not in this brush. It's definitely not me.
You should dive. You should
definitely
100%
dive. Like, just because he can't peek in doesn't mean that I'm not here.
Now, the problem for H2K is, and this is definitely not a huge problem, is that you get the Baron so early that you can't actually use it to finish the game because you're still too early, like you can't just dive turrets.
It's like when you inherit a million when you're 18. You haven't really developed the work ethic.
Right. Also, it could have been 2 million.
Could have been 2 million.
Sadly, you only get a million, so... They're still gonna be happy, of course, H2K.
Are they gonna wait for their second million? Or are they gonna at least open in the hip with this Baron?
I think they're gonna wait for the second one.
Yeah.
They got Infernal Drake, good investment.
Half a million.
Definitely half, close to.
Are you gonna wait for like 5 million like Origin? Or
that's
is too enough?
Barons. That's
too a lot of Barons.
That's a lot of Barons. Let's see what this is. So if you are Misfits, Crepo.
Yes, Divizio.
I hate obviously standing here and going like, oh, guys, still have a chance, it's okay, blah, blah, blah. But
Barcelona,
6-1.
They didn't have a chance.
I just think at this point in the game, like, we see this pretty often where you just fight down, like, you literally just have to rely on a mistake. Yes. Like, that's the only thing you can do.
And you gotta pull the trigger. The problem is, so many teams get prevented by, like, or presented with, like, kind of half mistakes, and they're like, no, we'll wait for more. No, you can't do that. Not against a team like H2K. But H2K is also a team that, in the past, has given up some of those mistakes.
Yeah, once per game, when they have fantastic early to mid games, they make that one mistake where they overchase and die. We actually talked to some of the players about it, and it was like, it's always based around, you know, greed. Yeah. Like, come on, we're so far ahead, guys. We can take this fight. Just go for it, you know, just kill this guy. And then they end up overchasing because they don't respect items that have actually been completed on the other side.
And that is an element of snowballing. You got to take slightly suboptimal plays that in an even fashion wouldn't work out. But because you're ahead, they will work out anyways, and you get even more lead. The problem is, if the risk assessment there goes wrong, you can throw a lot more than you gain.
So in this game, we don't want to see that, but Febivan jumping in. Got to respect the fact that Ryze can W him instantly, but that's why Febivan jumps in and uses ulti.
Ignar has a key role right now. He needs to prevent any damage he can, because Devour can be the ability that saves a fight.
Very true, but also Power Vivo with the W, with the Ruin Prison. Yep. Like, again, we saw Febivan instantly use Mimic to avoid obviously getting snared under the turret, but in a fight, if Febivan jumps in and Power Vivo instant snares him, they can then hook, you know, they can use
Depth Charge, Knock
Up, yeah. Anything, you know, the Q from Ivern, and then you can still burst down this LeBlanc. The problem is, of course, he has an Hourglass, so it becomes harder to do.
And he went for that super defensive build, which is fine as long as you build it ahead of the curve.
Also, you have magic damage from a Rumble that you also ends up buffing with the Abyssal Scepter, so it makes much more sense now than what Power of Evil did in the last game. And we're kind of just waiting for H2K to kind of
make a move.
No, well, they're waiting for Baron. We're waiting for H2K to go up and set up for Baron again, but why would you set up for Baron when he's not alive?
I mean, that's what you do all the time, right?
But they already have the setup, so.
Yeah. I think they're stalling right now. They're just keeping all the lanes pushed. Greed for H2K would be actually committing for a tier 1 tower, because committing right before Baron spawns is the way to throw a game.
So what they're doing is, wait for Baron. If Misfits wants to fight, perfect for H2K to take the fight.
Take the fight.
If they don't want to fight, you get another Baron, and you might have to wait for another Drake into an Elder Drake. Like, that's why some of these games sometimes, you know, really get to 40-ish minutes, even though a team is so far ahead. Just because pushing into the base with a very, very short travel time between Fountain and Turrets makes it difficult.
Makes it very difficult. The good thing is, though, H2K have done really good setup. The only problem that you could fault them for is that they don't have a ward in the pit, so technically there could be a blue trinket spotting Nashor right now. They have 4 control wards in the enemy jungler. They are really shutting down the entry wards. They're dewarding the best they can. So that means once the Nashor spawns, Misfits have an incredibly long route to take into Mount Doom.
Very true. Another problem for H2K when it comes to pushing is that Rumble, while he's winning the bottom lane, he's a melee champion. So he can't really get in and start hitting the tower because he has to respect the Nautilus. So they don't have anyone who can actually get damage on a turret. There's Ruin Prison from Ryze. That's why Baron is the objective.
And they're just instantly hard committing. They're not giving Misfits a single moment to breathe. They obviously, they can only transport 2 members in, and even then it would be a 50-50 steal for Kakao. And now the problem is this Rumble that could previously not hit the turret can just guide the minions in, and then obviously chip damage can happen.
I mean, another thing you can also start seeing is like Banner of Command gets completed. I think if you're Che, getting a Locket is fantastic.
But you don't need it.
But you don't actually need it, because you need to win the game before we get to like full late game. So getting like a Banner of Command, buff a minion in the bottom lane where the Nautilus sitting, he can't kill that. And then suddenly you can actually get damage on the tower.
POE gets chained up, has the Ruin Prison ready, but Jankos is in support. Che looking to help his team as well. 1 or 2 traps go down. Oduamne was ready to join, but he's peeling off again, buffing creeps in different lanes.
Yeah, you always have to push multiple lanes of your H2K, because whenever you go for one lane, you allow Caitlyn to set up her traps, and then you can't really get to the turret. So I really want to see that banner just to have the Oduamne lane getting pressure on the tower.
There's quite some frustration, I feel, in H2K right now, because they get the Nashor, they don't base immediately. They go for a bit of a push, like, let's base anyways.
Right.
So they essentially just waste a minute on their Nashor buff before they're in full formation.
Something we've seen before from them again, it's the one thing we often criticize them for. The late game blunders. I think Misfits, when it comes to the kind of proving they can be a defensive team, didn't really impress us in this game specifically. They fell really far behind very early.
If you play this style of composition, you cannot afford to make any mistakes. This is the type of draft, if we see it versus a team like H2K from Fnatic, we would be critical.
Yeah. Now, they're still in the game because H2K can't break into this base. They simply don't have enough damage, enough time to get these turrets in. Oduamne will work in. At this point, just Don't flame spitter, walk in, hit the tower a few times, walk out.
Walk out, yeah.
You can do that because you just want to grind them out.
BOE gets a big chain right there. That could be actually the opening here because Jay is joining and Fabi is actually getting the hits that they need on the turret.
This is very key because all the traps from Caitlyn is in the mid lane. Fabian is the ranged champion with access to the turret.
But Jankos is doing Dragon at the same time, so H2K is playing on too many fronts at the same time.
But Misfits, they don't know. Until they actually see the Dragon die.
Yeah. They may pull the trigger the second they hear that sound.
We're close, guys, we're close. Everyone in the crowd can't wait for... Oh, Odo, he stopped using Flame Splitter. He's hitting the tower.
He's hitting the tower. He's to the Fissure, but they see Dragon go down, so they know Jankos is not there. So that could be Odo Wamne dropping. Let's look at the other side. Can PoE survive the engage? Yes. He went off, but Febivan took another turret down in the bottom lane. Oduwamne is still alive.
He's buying time. He's just buying time. Now, probably will kill him, but it doesn't matter because H2K wanted the base.
Yeah. So actually, the sound of a dying dragon is what it took for H2K to finally be able to break open the base because Misfits could not defend on all fronts at once.
And now you have open top lane. You have Inhib already down bot lane. You have a second Infernal for H2K. With a composition where multiple members will benefit from it, not just, you know, one or two carries. The Rumble stacking full IP as well.
They also have Misfits down in the dumpster, 15,000 gold.
So that was a step one of the siege. Now there's the inner ring as well with the Nexus turrets you gotta get through. That tends to get a little bit easier when you got super minions with you.
Unless you give your opponents Varus.
Unless you give them Varus and Victor.
And Victor.
And then you get caught twice.
And you get caught twice.
We're not thinking of any specific team or game.
Hypothetically
right now.
Speaking, that would not be a great idea.
No. Especially not if you wear pink outfits.
Yep. And you were playing against a Swedish AD carry.
So I don't think people get it, but I did once see an NA, a team with a Wild Turtle on it, TSM, survive with three inhibs down, and they won the game. So let's put all the blame on North America. Would never happen in Europe.
No.
Only in NA.
do not follow that statement. I hereby resign from the statement.
Well, they still got banned off Mitch for a few seconds.
I love how we're switching here between names and actually caster tags.
Did I say Crepo at any point?
You did call me Crepo once.
I only call you Crepo when I'm mad at you.
When you're angry.
When you've been naughty, I'm like, Crepo!
Call me with my gamer tag. A lot of traps here. Who's going to take it?
Come on, Jankos.
Take one for the team. It's the headshot. You know you want it.
I mean, you could just go bottom with your super minions and force Misfits down there.
That's
and then you get some damage on mid tower. So it's just this very slow grind where you're just getting a bit of damage every single time and you're not giving Misfits a chance to come back.
Yeah, Alfari hiding in the brush. That must be some tall weed to hide massive anchor.
Now, Group A, Mitch, where Misfits is currently sitting, behind G2 Esports. Nothing will actually change in the overall standings because Fnatic have been losing.
Yeah.
G2 has been winning. So Misfits, let's see, Ansama might go low.
Ansama might be losing.
Damn.
Blue Prism wasn't enough. Everyone jumps back in. Jankos now. Everyone dodges the Death Charge with the Zonias. And at this point, H2K should be able to take the fight here. Redemption comes in. Look at how packed they are. Nuclear opens up onto Ignar. He has to flash out. Has Devour still available. PoE looking for damage, but the objective's the inhibitor. It falls. Alfari soaking up right now. Ignar as well. Have to disengage. PoE under pressure. Gets chain. Drops. Jankos goes in. Devour saves him, but it's not enough. And slowly but surely, all the damage is dropping down the Misfits one by one. And now the Nexus turrets are under siege.
Oh, and Sama actually stayed alive. Could be important if he can come back out here and defend. Odamne and Febivan on the tower. Everyone is alive from H2K.
Yeah, Febivan, they're looking to the Nexus. They're dropping an attack. Can they get the Nexus? They get it. H2K 2-0 the Misfits.
We said it in Champ Select, Mitch. H2K's composition would win the early game. It would win the mid game. Misfits surrendered everything early on. Went for full scaling. And then level 2. They give away first blood.
Yeah, but they give away their Raptors. Even if nobody dies right there, it was just a great start because Jankos was a full step ahead of Kakao.
I think H2K will look at this situation and say, our jungler is so good early game that we should always be able to snowball with this kind of comp. It's not a question if they can. The question is, can they then finish the game without, you know, taking a bad fight? In this game here, they played it so clean.
I would have loved to see this game with a single ward at the entrance on the ramp from the Misfits, so at least the Kao was aware of what was going on, and he could maybe react and invade. The problem is he would still be invading in between two pushing lanes, so that would make it very hard. Ivan is a champion that can do that.
Yeah. It's just all about awareness.
Yep.
You know, your mid laner actually expecting, I could get ganked from this side, which he should have expected, seeing as We saw the two camps go down.
Yeah.
We can't check the two camps as well.
Yeah, that's a major communication mistake.
But yeah, really, really well played by H2K. So as I just touched on here in the end, you know, Group A, nothing changes. Misfits are the second best team in that group. They will stay the second best team as well because Fnatic are not able to kind of pick up wins underneath them. Group B, however, that's where we have the competition for first place. Unicorns and H2K both tied, and Splice just under them winning games.
Yeah, it was a super important victory here for H2K. And also, I think they look stronger than the Unicorns recently, even though the score is tight, because they're on the up and up. Unicorns struggling right now. And it makes me happy as well, because that means the top two teams are not all in Group A. Say Misfits beat H2K here, then you have like a really stacked Group A.
Fair.
With people trailing behind. The groups are extremely even.
And this is the kind of game, if you are the Misfits, you know, after such a great spring split already as a new organization in the LCS, like, it sucks to lose, but at the same time, you're like, yeah, we're not perfect. You know, we have to learn, we have to improve on certain things. And you'd rather learn that now than in 4 weeks when we're sitting in a quarterfinal.
And I think if you talk to their coaching staff, which is honestly pretty well-rounded, they're also okay and accepting of that, because they changed, like, especially the way they approach their games, the fact that they're willing to change play styles. They changed a working product, turned it upside down last week, to then practice more for the playoffs. It indicates that they're okay with losses, and granted, their buffer against Fnatic is going to help that as well.
Yeah, and if, you know, the season or regular season ended right now, Misfits would play a quarterfinal against Splice, which is a very likely scenario because Splice have a few wins before they can actually catch Unicorns and H2K. And of course, the other one would, at the moment, be Unicorns versus Fnatic as the other quarter. So Misfits could still dodge around G2, which is important.
But let's talk H2K real quick. Major flaw for them was greed, overchasing, not communicating well or getting too chaotic in the fights. I don't think we really saw it.
Not in this game. Not in this series. Yeah. I think H2K played some really, really solid League of Legends where you can always argue, why don't you finish the game faster? But like, you are against wave clear, Caitlyn
traps. If you don't have to.
If you don't have to. They were playing for the second Baron. As soon as they had that second Baron, we saw them break into the base. We saw Fibbon get some damage down. And then it's a slow and steady and not giving the enemy team a chance.
Yeah. No, I definitely agree right there. H2K solidifying themselves as a really strong team. Worked on some issues. Martin pointing at something that is not appropriate for broadcast. But we'll be joining a member of H2K in the post-game lobby. But let's first go to Stress, who's standing by.